Happy Sunday. It is a new week and a new lecture. It is my intention that you all are being divinely and safely guided through every day and every action. I was telling my husband yesterday that every day is like Groundhog's Day. We get up with this idea about the world and the things that are supposed to happen in mind, and we allow ourselves to be led by intuition, whatever it is we feel about the outside world. And so many things, including the encounters with the people in our lives, or maybe it's something we saw on the internet or someone we saw at the store, can influence the energy that we carry with us every day. We, at least a lot of us, I'll say myself, have kind of stopped counting the days and the months and the minutes and the hours, and it's just living in the moment as best as possible. Because I think that with this whole age of awakening, a lot of people are finally leaning into the fact that time is really just a construct. It's only a construct. So any ramifications we're putting around when something has to be done, or when we're going to forgive that person by, or when we're going to get to the next level, it doesn't exist. The frequency of fear is one of the main things that holds us back, and that is deeply rooted at the base of our spine. It's one of the first things that we develop when we come into the world, before we're even outside of the womb, within our mother. Whatever she feels at the time, we feel. Those emotions are transferred over through the umbilical cord, through chemicals, through energy that's happening inside of our bodies. And, you know, when I started my spiritual journey, learning about the energy centers was fascinating to me, because I was like, wow, everything is really connected. These spinning wheels and points that the ancients knew were inside of our bodies, and they knew how to manipulate like the Avatar. These things really can be balanced. They're not so out of our control that they cannot be, but we've gotten so used to not only distracting ourselves, but using pretty much anything as an excuse as to why we are so out of tune with self. And, you know, we live in a different world, much different world than probably the one in which those texts were written. There are so many attachments, like that of social media, that of a life of gratification. A lot of people have forgotten what struggle and challenges are, and that they are lessons and they're not always meant to just cause pain. That suffering is a part of the journey, but that doesn't mean that it's a bad thing, that it can be beautiful. And I think that fear can also be a beautiful thing. I think that fear is something that is created from the feeling of not having, not feeling like you belong, not feeling like you're worthy enough, not feeling like you have the right to be simply exactly who you are in this experience. And so that can carry you throughout your entire journey. And if you don't fix what's at the root first, then you're going to have a dead tree. I've been noticing lately and hearing, even in things I've been watching, how much humans are trees. And even hearing about elders, I heard a comment from someone, or saw a comment from someone on one of my videos, telling me that in Seattle, Washington, in certain reservations, they tell them about how certain ancestors were petrified in wood. And I was like, well, that makes all the sense in the world, because I've heard people say in passing, oh, the ancestors are in nature, they're in our trees. No, like, their actual bodies were turned into petrified wood at one point. I can honestly get with that story. I know there are many myths and folklores and tales, but myths and folklores are tales just because they come from stories usually that actually happen, but we're so out of tune with that reality that we're more caught up in the digital one. And I'm not saying that both worlds can't be navigated, because a long time ago, the ancestors that we have who are organic to the world, they came from the sea to come onto land and then merge with both worlds. And then they also had the technology as well. So I don't really think it's a matter of having to choose one or the other. It's when you're a navigator, you know how to guide your ship. The world is getting so crazy right now that I think more people are waiting around for something big to happen, and therefore losing their grip on reality and life, because they're like this, waiting. I'm gonna grab a phone so y'all see, like, waiting for something to happen. And in doing that, they're letting every fear trigger that fight or flight in their head, that adrenaline, and they stand in inaction. I am like, I guess because I was there at the beginning of the internet, before media was used for real mass manipulation, I remember what it was like not getting on a phone and looking at the news and all the terrible things happening in the world. And now people do, and it's either does a few things. It either makes them angry and makes them a media, a digital keyboard warrior or activist, or they do nothing. And it's like, okay, come on, you're in control of your situation. Even if you see this thing on your phone, does that change your reality right now? And I'm not saying don't care. I am not that person. I'm not that person who's going to tell you don't care. I'm not the person who's going to tell you that it's not important. I'm saying, how is this affecting your reality right now? What is it creating? What emotions are being created inside you when you read and see things like this? What can you do right now about this? First within and then without. Would you like to take massive action against this? If so, how are you going to go about doing that? Can you do so with a balanced and neutral heart? Because everything you see that's happening that we call terrible in the outside world is also balance. And I really am uncomfortable with that sometimes, but also becoming one with all means you have to be comfortable with every outcome of every world that exists. And a lot of people are not ready to let go of that. They don't know that we get to choose the reality in which we live. And it doesn't mean that we don't care about other people or that we're saying, just let them suffer. Like, I mean, you see in everyday life, people want to suffer anyway. It's part of their journey. We have to be focused on, if we want to empower others, we have to focus on ourselves, because how are you going to lead a group of people or lead someone to enlightenment or freedom or anything like these ascended masters if you don't first know yourself, know thyself? All the ancient texts say, know thyself. We think we have such a grip and a handle on the craziness of the world, like, oh, I can fix it. If we could fix it, it wouldn't be like it was right now. And not everything is meant to be fixed. There are certain programs and operations that have to have their place and run in order for the world to run like it is. Think of it like a balancing of karma. Good and bad have to run together. So because of that, nothing really is good and nothing really is bad. There are only good actions and bad actions. People run at the vibration and the frequency so that they're built on. And if they never go past that, well, that's where they stay. I've learned a lot about the middle path, and I think that's where I'm at least for now. Because I know that there's always the possibility, based on the things that you've been through, that you could be the villain in someone's story, but you could also be the hero. It's all about outlook and output. It's also about looking within. We are walking, talking computers every day. Our eyes are the cameras. Our mouth is the microphone. Our ears are the input-output audio. Our pineal gland, well, that's the main server right there. Also connected to the heart. And so, if you know that, and you know that is how we operate, you know how we turn our phones on with the expectation of it just running perfectly and we never turn it off and we never give it a break. Like, I literally have to make myself turn my phone off at night. Because if I'm a phone or I'm a computer, I have to turn myself off and give myself the proper rest so I can regulate my body and bring it back up to speed to where it needs to be so that I can do things that are important to me. Things that I connect with. If I live in the frequency of fear, you got to remember these mechanical objects that we use that have pretty much taken over the entire world. I'm getting to that in a minute. They are made up of the same things we are, literally. How do you think somebody came up with that? They used organic materials in order to create these motherboards, these operating systems that run on certain programs, and they've only gotten more advanced over time. Humans have actually been the ones who have been slowing down. So when I do some of my esoteric like decodes on TikTok that I'm so into because I just find it fascinating, not because I'm like, Jedi Knight teacher. I noticed that the world is kind of going into the events of the movie The Terminator with Arnold Schwarzenegger. And what I find funny about this is that, the whole movie is about the rise of the machines. We've been seeing these movies since we were a kid, like iRobot, Bicentennial Man, Terminator 1, 2, and 3. And it's a dramatic stage play of what is happening, because I think like I'm sitting around here like, okay, when is it actually going to happen? But the interesting thing is that it already has happened. In that movie, they talk about facial recognition, they talk about home robots, and the thing is, they're already out. Y'all have seen Elon Musk's Optimus Prime, the Sophia robot from Hanson Robotics. The whole trope that they used to have with Austin Powers and the Fembots, if y'all have seen the Stepford Wives, it's already happened. I have a Roomba in here right now. Like, I'm talking in a microphone on the screen. Like, there's really no separation right now between humans and technology. And so they're not aware of being at the frequency of fear because it's almost embedded into their minds at this point, if you do not have a grip on reality and a grip on self. And just that alone, like knowing that these things in the movies are not jokes, they're real. They are very dramatized up to a certain point because that's what the media is. It's the drama of everything. It kind of just gives you some perspective, like, okay, well, this is the way things could go, and this is the way that they're actually going. And right now, if I had to be completely honest, the way they're going is a little bit insane on the outside world, but that doesn't mean that my world stops or your world has to stop. It means that you get a grip and you control the system before it controls you. You have to. It is the only way to maintain some form of balance. Being in control of the self means that you are at balance with the physical human experience that is going on right now. And the physical experience is going to require you to know that you are just a soul traveling in a physical body. When you have that phone in your hand, people can lose their grip on reality with these in their hands because they're gripping their phones. They're losing reality. They're like this: scroll, 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 swipe, like, share, comment, express my emotions. I don't like this. I don't like that. And I make videos too, y'all. So this is not me talking about people. What I'm saying is that this is how we look now as a society. We can't even practice kundalini energy properly, like meditating and sitting up straight and allowing energy to flow, because we've turned into those cavemen. I'm gonna post a picture. Those cavemen that they say that we were. I mean, look at what the pandemic did. We've gone backwards in time, literally. Not maybe in the ways of the writing, but one of my favorite stories is Plato's Cave Allegory. And Plato's cave allegory goes like this. So there are people in a cave and they're watching these pictures projected on the screen. There's a light show, there's fire, and these little characters moving across the screen all day. And they never come out from the cave until one day, one person goes out and they go out to explore. And they find out the world is not what they thought it was. I'm like, wow, this is life. This is the world. And so they go back and they try to tell everybody. Nobody believes him. And he lets them affect his frequency and goes back in the cave again. These images, these videos that we see, that's not real life. But we have the ability to utilize this device, this program in the best ways we know how in order to get messages to each other so we can kind of bring each other out of the cave. I think technology has a great place. I think it was a great idea, and it can do wondrous things that can help revolutionize the world, especially when it comes to the convenience of things, but maybe not the convenience of everything because we stop learning how to use our brains. I hear people so obsessed on like TikTok and YouTube with, oh, we knew how to fly once, we knew how to levitate. Okay, but like, what are you doing with that right now? You're obsessed with something that has no concept in this time right now because of the society we live in. Now, don't get me wrong, I know somewhere in, Asia or in India or somewhere where they do not have the same values as us, and I'm not saying the big cities, I mean like the off-grid countries somewhere, there are people who have these abilities because they don't do what we do. And if we want those abilities, well, we're going to have to create a very different society. We're going to have to take care of our minds, because the fear is that, oh, we'll end up in the sunken place. I'm like, baby, we're already there. A lot of us have already been there. I know me, like I used to get so depressed when I started becoming enlightened to knowledge. I became so depressed that this was what the world really was, that I went right back into the cave again. Like seriously, it was like a 6-month binge of Grey's Anatomy. And we know what doctor shows are like. And so after that, I woke back up again. I'm like, okay, I have to go back into the matrix, back into the world and tell people like, okay, this is going on. And sometimes I would get attached. I'm like, oh, I don't have that many followers. I'm like, girl, snap out of it. This isn't Ready Player One. This is not Ready Player One. You're playing a video game for sure. The video game that is life. But it doesn't matter if 3 or 4 people are listening to you, as long as you're getting up every day and you're aligning with that frequency where you release the fear, you go into creativity, you believe in yourself, you trust in your heart, you use your voice to communicate your truth. You speak from the mind that's connected to the heart, and you understand you are connected to everything. You have nothing to fear, nothing to worry about. Every day stops becoming Groundhog's Day at that point. Things transform little by little. My husband grows plants. They start from seeds, literal seeds. One day, you see a little sprout. Then I go by, do the same thing every day for like the next week, next 2 weeks. And all of a sudden, they look a little taller. And I'm like, wow, growth. We have an opportunity every day to transform the world. Every day. And it's all about where your mind is. I like doing esoteric decodes, because there's so much that is hidden in plain sight, so much that it's a little thrilling, but also a little terrifying that there are many that are tapped into this knowledge who have decided to use it for purposes that did not benefit the population. And then there are some people who don't know and they're fine with not knowing. And you can't force them into being ready for that part of the journey. But if you're here for the lecture, most likely you are, because you've enjoyed my decodes or seeing something along the way. I still know that there is a future already. I've seen the futures that exist. You know how like, and I think it was Multiverse of Madness, or maybe it was one of the Doctor Strange movies. They were saying that they had seen, no, you know what? I take that back. That was Loki. There was a guy called The Conqueror. And he had seen every outcome of everything that was going to happen. I've seen it actually in several shows. They're like, oh, we've seen the outcome of everything that's supposed to happen. Society went this way and then they went that way. Because of the algorithm, because of the things that have happened along the timeline of life, humans are predictable. They've done the same thing over and over and over again. They choose the same over and over and over again. But now that we are shifting into this age of awakening, which has good and bad parts, it's not all good, it's not all bad, people are kind of diverting from the program and the algorithm that was set. So now a new algorithm is being created. When you pause on thoughts for even a second, you have to remember that your computer is picking up on everything you're doing. This is why I have to switch it up so often with what I'm doing. I don't want to be predictable. I want every day to wake up and feel something different, to do something different, to choose something different, and be in control of that as much as I can. Not of the situation, but of myself. So I know a lot of people struggle with, well, how do I get to that point? Some people just want to know, how can I decode? Well, decoding requires you to let go of the human experience and see everything as a joke. And I'm gonna be honest, just to like kind of tell a funny story. The first time, there's 2 times I let go of my reality. The first time was when I was 19 and I had an LSD trip. And the second time was when I ate way too many weed cookies and saw myself on the Truman Show, only it was the Taylor Show. And now sitting in front of the camera with the ring light, I'm like, well, this is a Taylor Show, so I'm going to take advantage of the situation. There's a thing that happens when you raise your frequency to certain levels. You see yourself as a character and not as yourself. Because if you think about it, if your soul has traveled through many lifetimes and it has inhabited many bodies, there is nothing more than a program, a story being told, and you have to fulfill that story in order to get to the next level. You have to play that character. For example, my character is the Cinderella character. The prince and the pauper, the Buddha, the ascended master who was once, you know, came from what most would call a privileged lifestyle, then fell off because I wanted to seek true meaning in the world. And then slowly but surely, I built myself back up the ladder again, and I'm still going right now on an effort to reach enlightenment. And enlightenment, I don't think is one place. I think it's just a state of awareness where you realize that this is a self-led journey. This is self-led. And when you get to that point for certain people, you become a seeker of truth and then a teller of truth. And then all you know is truth. And the truth is, everything just is. Everything is everything, like Lauryn Hill says. Everything is everything. The celebrities, the TVs, the shows, the politics, the musicians, the wars, the drugs, all of that. It's a part of a program. Like if you've played The Sims, Grand Theft Auto, people are obsessed with the fact that this is a simulation. I'm like, I don't have that obsession as much because I played The Sims for a very long time. And I always had the awareness that we were living in an advanced version of the world, but I didn't really tap into that till I got older. And so you think, okay, if this is a computer program and it's not really about who's in control at the end of the day, you are. Would you believe that you're in a future reality with a controller in your hand guiding this game? I mean, they've shown it in movies like Interstellar, where they show you entering the fourth dimension, the fifth dimension, the sixth dimension, seventh dimension. Actually, I don't even know where they ended up. But that's like the whole gist of like Marvel movies. They're after this Tesseract, this time cube, Saturn's time cube, because they want to control reality. They put it in every show recently. It's either about the ending of all humans and all of civilization or the changing of timelines, because everything that happens in the media is matching up with the things that are happening now. Like I said, humans are predictable, so they're like half a step ahead with the information that they get. And the information they get is from psychics who are trained to infiltrate human minds. And this is not some woo-woo shit, guys. Like, again, you got to break down everything you think you know about your reality. Everything. Nothing is simple, but it's all simple. Nothing is complicated, but it's all complicated. We live in an eye. If you pay attention to an eye and the makeup of it, it is a swirling storm. I'm going to post another picture from this album I was listening to. And within it is every part of the human experience, every possible reality, every possible choice you could have made, that you did make, that you thought about making. Every person, every way you could have gone in life exists within the eye. This is why we have recently gone through the coronavirus. The coronavirus is the crown virus. And this is a private YouTube, so luckily and hopefully this will not get taken down because I said the dirty word. But it is the crown virus. Corona is Latin for crown. Why would they name a virus after crown? Well, you got to think about the events of 2020 and what happened. It took away almost, well, if you made certain decisions, it took away your ability to see, to tap into the all. And I got caught up in it too. I didn't know what was happening. I came to my awakening. But we were all in the house. We were all paranoid. We were all sucked into this program. They were running a program and they were seeing how we were going to respond to it. And we all fell for it, at least most of us who weren't that enlightened back then. And a lot of us were in fear. It created division in our families. We became isolationists, became very greedy. We became in survival mode and we turned into cavemen. Cavemen who now have pretty lights and never go outside and until, you know, it was time to come outside again. And they're going to run this program again. They're going to do it every year until humanity has evolved enough to do something different. And everything that you see on the media is going to be an extension of that, including your fearmonger, conspiracy theorist, the people who are telling the truth, who just want people to know, and your people who are in full denial and would rather attach to someone else's story than live in their own. So that's a lot to make you think, wow, this is life. This is the eye. The crown virus, in my opinion, has more to do with not just the levels of enlightenment, but our connection to the human experience, because these phones, in a way, have disconnected us if we're not using them for the right reasons. Also, if we don't have the ability to get off of them and go outside, that's hard too. I know there were times where I treated my phone like my baby, like I wouldn't let it go. You gotta let it go. This is why they constantly throw out like the fear program, like, ooh, the power grid and stuff. I'm not saying it's not gonna happen, but y'all say the same thing every day, every month, every year, and I have not seen it yet. I haven't seen it yet, and maybe that exists in somebody's reality, and that's fine. For me, if it happens, it happens. If it doesn't, it doesn't. Living in Louisiana has taught me a lot, like, especially in a place where hurricanes happen. Because if your power is out, and you have no internet, and you gotta get trapped in the house with your family, make a party out of it. If you don't have anybody, get creative. Go write a book, go outside and explore, see what's out there. The internet has made everybody afraid of the outside world. They have made them afraid of believing in themselves, of creating anything outside of themselves, outside of only what they can produce on an app. And don't get me wrong, I think there's a lot of great information, but people can get stuck and trapped in the chakra. Meaning that they never root themselves, and every day they're just trying to figure out another conspiracy theory, or every day they're trying to freak out about the world ending. And it's like, you have to come down from that. Every day you cannot be so stuck in the spiritual that you forget that this is still a physical experience in this game we're living out. Nobody's coming to get us anytime soon. I mean, if they were, they'll come and I'll be wrong, but this is about living out what we're supposed to. And I got to that point too. I had to learn how to navigate myself, especially working with psychedelics and cannabis, which is something I do not promote, but I talk about how it has helped my consciousness speed up along the process of evolution that we're on right now. Because I would watch these shows and movies and I'm like, oh, is something about to teleport me up into the sky? And like, come on now. It's not that these things don't happen. It's not that they don't. It's the sitting in, waiting around for something to happen frequency that I'm talking about. It's the, I wonder if one day a UFO will come snatch me up. You know, that was something that happened on The Sims 2, by the way. Like, I think it was like The Sims 3, because I think that we're evolved versions of that program. And I remember when I first got the game as a kid, there was a thing where you could get a telescope and go outside, and every night you could sit out there for hours and wait to see if an alien abduction happened. People are just now getting awareness that the ocean is space. And I think that's like scary enough. Because now people are waiting for mermaids to come out of the ocean. Even I was listening to people on YouTube that were like, okay, y'all, the Nomos are coming. And don't get me wrong, 2023 is not over yet. If some mer people jump out, I will welcome the ones that are family with open arms. But until then, I think these people, these ancestors or these beings that were always waiting around are actually us. We're calling things foreign and saying, oh yeah, this is happening. It's us. These story writers, these storytellers, these muses, this fiction, these magical creatures are us. We have forgotten who we are. Even like in watching, like I'll talk about Once Upon a Time, and somebody came in my comments and was like, a grown woman talking about fairy tales. Fairy tales were written, a lot of them were written by the Brothers Grimm. Where do you think the Brothers Grimm got those ideas? Ancient Egyptians, ancient Lemurians. They didn't just pull these stories out of their butt. They've been keeping up. Like, this has been a game of consciousness for a very long time. And imagine someone is conscious to information about magical worlds, and they're like, okay, well, you know what would be great? If I could write it in a book and tell people these stories, and they get so entranced with the story that they never live their actual life. They don't know that these are the characters that we're writing about. They think that this is separate from them. They don't think this is their story. And it continues. Then you have the Duffer brothers, you know, Stranger Things, the Wachowski twins writing The Matrix. Like, and they didn't, we're not going to get into that one. truth knowers know about the whole Matrix thing, but it's beside the point. The point is, and I saw this in a Disney movie, actually, and I know how Disney works, Phantasmagoria and all that, but there's this movie that I watched with my son about elves, and it's called Onward. And the beginning of the movie starts with, the world was once a magical place, and it shows how we had magic with our hands creating electricity, and then all of a sudden someone converted it to a switch. And then they go on just to show like how all these magical creations were condensed into conveniences. And so the things that made us powerful, now anybody has access to. I, like a lot of my favorite teachers, are doing our best to lead people back into that power that they have. Decoding is a power because my brain works very, very fast. And sometimes I shy away from that. I'm like, okay, maybe I'm doing too much. Maybe I'm talking too much. Maybe people won't understand what I'm saying, but there are some people whose brains are working at that level and that speed. And for the people who actually are interested in what I'm saying and want to get to know, I'm here to help bring them back up to speed again. I'm here to help them charge their computer. But the computer also needs to rest at night. Your brain can't go all night. You'll crash and burn out. Like when you have your phone in your hand for too long and it gets hot, it cannot handle all that information at once. Close out the tabs, turn it off, go outside, go meditate. Disconnect from that part of the experience, because once you do, amazing things can happen, but you have to be willing to let go of the unknown. And by the unknown, I mean anything that they tell you that is happening. Because I know, like, I like watching gematria decoders. Gematria is an ancient language of coding words into numbers that they use, like, in media, on television, when releasing movies, all of that. A lot of them are rituals because everybody is in service to the Great Mother at the end of the day. And when I say in service to, I mean, like, all these major corporations like Amazon, Meta, even the Pope, they serve the Mother because she is the great balancer of all things. The only reason they're able to stay in power is because they follow the karma and they serve her, even for wicked purposes. There's no choice. I think that people think that this great being that watches all over us has a choice. Like, they could come and save us, or they could do this. There's no choice. We are the choice because we are the human expression. We are the physical expression of the Great Mother who created all of this in the material form. And the material form is so caught up in the material experience, it no longer recognizes the soul's presence. You got to get back in touch with that. You have to see that you are more than just this physical experience. And when you do, you are able to move through it faster. Like when you master a new video game. I talked about before, when I was younger, I played the Harry Potter game. I think I played like the Goblet of Fire maybe. And I felt so good when I finally like mastered which way was which and how to get through certain levels. I'm like, okay, I got this. I got this. I got this. And then one day there was a storm, and I still remember like it was yesterday. Lightning came on and the power was out, and the power was connected to the light switch at the time. I don't know how 90s houses were, or early 2000s. And I had to start my game all over. I had to adjust. I had to adapt. But I already knew where I needed to go in order to get there. And so, yeah, I had to walk the green mile again. I had to figure things out, but I knew how to master the game at that point. Life is a game to be mastered. You can get caught up every day in all the conspiracy theories happening. You can get caught up in the spiritual part of the experience, or you can navigate your ship through both. The reality of it is, there is no reality. There's no one set reality. Everybody experiences something different depending on their story and their program. I use the term, we are computer programs, because that's literally what it is. It's a computational device. What is computation? Let's look up the definition, because I want to give y'all exact words so you know. And we're going to go to the etymology definition. Computation. Act, process, or method of arithmetical calculation. From past, present, participle stem of computare, to sum up, reckon, compute, from com, with together. Originally, to prune, to cut, strike, stamp, a result of computation, amount of reckon. So what does that tell us? Our life is nothing but one big calculation. It's a calculation of experiences. It's a calculation of emotions. It is a calculation of the actions that we take. We are creating the algorithm for every human that comes after us based on our choices. Some humans will live at one level, other humans will live at another. We call it frequency. Some people call it new earth. I think there's always been other earths. There's always different versions. Where you live is dependent on you. You could be like, yeah, I live in the United States of America in 2023, and this is real life. And somebody else can be like, oh, well, I live in Nirvana. I live in a place where there are no worries, there are no troubles, there's only existence. I don't attach myself to any particular feeling because I know that this is the experience. And I'm only here to live it out for a short time and then I'm gone again. For me, the older I get to certain parts of my journey, because I sometimes wonder too, I'm like, when is it all going to be over? Like, when will I have learned everything? But the thing is, like, I've manifested my life and I've always told myself from the very beginning, I'm going to pass on at a very old age because there's so much I still want to see and so much I want to do and accomplish because it's part of my experience. It's part of my computer program. The two people who came together to make me each had their own story. They had their own running programs. And so those two programs came together to create me. Well, then one part of the program diverted and did something else, and a new person came into the program. And these three people in my life, my mother, my dad, my stepfather, created the program that is me. I get to run that algorithm at that point. And then I got with my husband, and our children are going to have an algorithm based on what we teach them every day, which is kindness, which is joy, which is nature, which is love, which is sometimes technology as well, which is learning to live and move through this experience. I've heard so many different ways of life, people who are like hard on vegans and vegetarians, people who don't really think about how food or anything determines their frequency, though it does, I'm not gonna lie. But people who also live pretty happy lives with most to nothing, and that's just how they live every day. I think that when we realize we are in the driver's seat, fate and all, we have more control than we think we have. We have more abilities than we think that we have. And it's simply our ability to believe in them. I think a lot of people just have a hard time attaching to the belief. And that takes me all the way back to the beginning of the lecture. It's the root chakra, what exists there. The fear, the belonging, the right. The inherent right as every human to be and live in this experience. Then you get to a point where you make certain choices for your life. For me, mine was complete and total sovereignty. That is what I'm working towards right now. Because I kept realizing there is nothing that is holding me back but me. Like, I sent an email, for example, yesterday to one of my favorite teachers. I've been running my podcast for about a year. I stopped. My last episode was May 5th, but I'm starting it up again. And I wrote a message asking if I could invite him on the podcast. I probably sat for a good 3 minutes just looking at the screen like, should I send it? Should I send it? What if he says no? What if I look like a butt? What if I never moved on to the moment of me being in the line with what I wanted to see happen was that I get him on my show. And so I had to step out of that frequency and move into the creation portion, then the belief portion. These are the lower emotions that we have, the energy in motion. Remember, an emotion is just an energy in motion. It is an attachment. The way you feel is just a story that has been created for you that is being run. It's only a story. And so when you are able to move past that part and like, okay, I can create this and move past this, you don't stay so stuck on the program somebody else ran for you. You create your own. My program is to create healing and happiness for people, to build a foundation to show them that everything that we want the world to be is from within. We create our own world. We are universes inside of other universes inside of other universes. I'm the person at this point who's going to make you aware to everything that they've put in the media at this point that makes you think that this is a real experience. It's only real because you say it is. It's only real because you believe it is. And I know a lot of people are not ready for that. They're like, so you're just going to say that child trafficking doesn't happen. You're just going to say that wildfires aren't happening. People aren't getting killed. I'm not saying any of that. I think that the earth is cleansing itself. The computer's going through a reboot. This is a reset. The reset is the realigning of all values that create the human experience. Everything from money to media to water to anything that you can think of. And where you live is right up here. You create that. So if you look at everything bad happening, like, oh my gosh, I just can't believe all these bad things are happening all the time. What are you going to do about it? Are you going to live at the frequency that you just can't believe it happened? You're going to just say, oh, these people are so wicked all day? Yeah, they are. Let them be wicked. You do what you can to help elevate the planet. You do what you can to help move things forward along this path. I see that a lot, especially with, and I know it's a touchy subject, but these things that have happened in Maui, or not Maui, in Lahaina. Never would I say I don't care about the death of innocents. Never would I say do I not care about people losing their homes. But how many times have we seen tragedy in this world happen over and over again? And how many times have we fed into it over and over again? The people that you think empower, they don't care. They're not worried about the next disaster. They're already planning the next one. While you're so worried about the thing that is happening in the right now, they're already planning for the next just based off of how you're acting. I mean, I've worked as a manager in customer service. I know that people are pretty predictable, and I've said it about 3 times already. The minute you react and you spend more time reacting than doing, you create a new program or the same program that's being run, and nothing ever changes. And now things are speeding up, so we see like more celebrities dying, more people who have signed up for these contracts that connect them to this realm. They're dying at a quicker rate because now the world is starting to speed up in the cleansing process. It is no longer going slow, like, oh, we're going kind of slow. You know when a computer boots up, it starts reaching. I mean, at least in the old Windows days, it was like, okay, your computer's loading 75%, 85%, 95%. Everything that is happening, even including like the power of the palm that they have coming out, scanning it, how they're not accepting cash in most places anymore. People are so worried about that they're not figuring out how can I combat this in my everyday life so I don't become a part of that system. They're too busy worried about it, not coming up with tangible solutions because their emotional centers cannot handle it. They have not mastered the root. They have not mastered the sacral. They have not mastered the solar plexus and everything that comes in between the 33 vertebrae and the 33 steps to enlightenment. You have to. There's no room for debate at that point. If you're not ready to do that, then you are going to live where they create that frequency. But you don't have to. Everything is a choice. So there is a lot going on. But let's bring it down now. Come back to self. Because we can get really worked up about all these things happening. And I know a lot of people are like, well, what do I do? What do I do? What do I do? We pause. We pause. We reflect. We let every thought and emotion come and pass. Again, remember, the coronavirus is one of the crown. It is about our levels of enlightenment, our expanded awareness, how well we are able to tap into the moment and be one with it. When we do that, we're feeding our brain more levels of oxygen that allow us to sustain this world under pressure. Pressure forms diamonds. We let the pressure come so that we are able to be compacted back into the stardust from which we were formed. Remember to breathe. Remember to come back to self. Remember, this is just an experience for a very short time. Live it to the best of your ability by looking within and going within self. So if you like this lecture, please share it with someone. I am posting them every Sunday on Patreon, coming here, showing my face. Check out the Tailored Healing Collective website. I am revving the community back up. I'm taking on consultations, speaking to people on how I can help them get to the next part of their journey, cultivating wellness routines, teaching one-on-one esoteric knowledge. I'm also promoting my album. I have a meditation album called Cosmic Roots, Healing Sounds and Affirmations. It's been out since 2021. It's available on all streaming platforms. Also, if you're interested in working with sacred medicine, if you're a mother, if you are curious about a life of transformation and what it looks like from someone who has worked in all of these realms, you can check out the Tailored Healing Collective podcast. I will link everything down there in the bio. Make sure to like and subscribe to the channel, and I look forward to sharing with you all soon.